start by telling you a little bit about the Columbia Fiction Foundry that's hosting this event, and then introduce Folio Literary Management that have joined us today. The Columbia Fiction Foundry's mission, our charter, is to assist Columbia alumni in improving our fiction writing and in getting published. So we're trying to help with both the craft of writing and the business of writing. And one thing that we've recognized is as writers, community is very important. Such a lonely profession. It's useful to have support from other writers. Our primary initiatives include a live workshop that meets once a month, usually the first Saturday of every month, for which there's a waiting list. But we're also expanding now to a virtual critique community called the Columbia Fiction Exchange that'll serve people even outside the New York area. And it also is a forum for exchanging larger manuscripts than we can deal with in a monthly workshop setting where we have to limit the number of words. And of course, we have periodic events like this one. Some of those have been posted on our website if you want to revisit those. And our website is also a resource for various links about writing and support for that. If you'd like to learn more about our organization, there are some of our members here, Julia, Ralph, Bill, who can tell you more. And Bill will be recording this for publication on YouTube, just so everybody is aware, to be discreet, if there's something that you don't...
It's the makeup artist, Mark.
Yeah, I think...
Where's wardrobe?
I want to thank you for coming. Jeff Kleinman, Erin Harris, Dado,
Derviskadic.
Derviskadic?
Yes.
Imagine Nervous Cottage, that's how you
thought I heard them all. Absolutely.
Thank you so much for coming. We're really delighted to have you and to learn from you. I've jotted some things down from your website. I love your mission statement. There's a couple of sentences from that I want to read to the group. You can learn more about them by visiting their website. Folio Literary Management places both fiction and nonfiction with major publishers, so one of the largest agencies, one of the top 10 in the United States. They represent many first-time authors, some of whom have gone on to become bestsellers and major award winners. And this I'm going to read from the mission statement. Everyone at Folio strongly believes that books can and do change lives and that well-told stories make a difference to the world. They say, we are the people who help bring an author's vision to life and help open readers' eyes to new vistas, new experiences, and new perspectives. For Folio agents, our work is not a job. It's a passion and an adventure we dive into every day. We like to think that at Folio, we have the best of both worlds. With over 20 agents, we have the experience, expertise, and strength people would expect from a company that is among the largest in the business. But because of the types of people we attract, we have that same spark and ingenuity people expect from much smaller agencies. And at this point, let me turn it over to the three of you to just introduce yourselves and add whatever you'd like to.
Who goes first?
Jeff?
Oh, man. So my name is Jeff Kleinman, and I was one of the people that started Folio, I guess, 10 years ago. There's actually about 15 agents at Folio, and we do have a lot of fun. I think the thing that I feel like makes us a little bit different is we're a medium-sized agency, so we're not huge like William Morris, and we're not a real boutique agency. It's just one person. But the nice thing I think is we kind of have this great mix where you have this sort of team. I sold this book a couple weeks ago, and we have. And so I can go out and work on another book, or I'm working on the same book with the author on edits. But in the meantime, they've sold this territory. They sold like 13 territories because we have foreign rights and like somebody else doing film. And so we have like the muscle of a bigger agency. But I think we're still very kind of small in our brains.
Culturally.
Culturally.
We're very collegial.
Yeah, we are, and I think it's really, this is a little bit of a dog-eat-dog business, where you feel like, I think from your perspective, there's a lot of times you're feeling like these agents are sort of these sharks, and they're trying to get the client, and I know that there are agents like that, I just really am not familiar with many of them, because it feels like all agents I know are tend to be really great, fun, outgoing, interesting people, and the people that we work with, I think especially, I feel like it's very, very collegial. We just had Putnam, which is an imprint of Penguin, over for drinks tonight, and we were talking to one of the editors, and we said something. I was talking to one of my colleagues, and we said that we co-agent a lot of projects. We work on projects together, and she said she'd never heard of that. And for us, it's totally common that we both work on projects together. And I think it makes sort of a nice group. It doesn't feel like you're competing. The kind of stuff I do I'm actually the one that drafted that mission statement. I'm the guy that I like doing novels that make me cry. It's one of my things, and narrative nonfiction that basically opens my eyes to something I hadn't seen before, some story that I thought I knew that it turns out I knew nothing about. So a couple books I've done is a book called Art Racing in the Rain by Garth Stein, which is a book narrated by a dog. And I remember when I went out with that book, I was like terrified because I guess 7-8 years ago, there weren't books narrated by dogs. And I was like, oh my God, I'm never going to sell this. And I was so in love with it. And I was like, every time I pick up the phone and talk to them, I was like just waiting for them to laugh at me and say, you idiot, there's no book that can work like this. But the book actually did nicely. So that kind of thing. For nonfiction, I did a book called, The Revision of Mockingbird is out, Harper Lee biography that's come out. And it's one of those things that's sort of hiding in plain sight. How come nobody's ever done a biography of Harper Lee? So enough about me. Erin.
I'm Erin Harris, delighted to be here. Thanks again for having us. I've always loved books. I had many friends growing up, but books ranked high among them. And I was also very involved in theater. And when I graduated from my undergraduate, I was sort of torn in those two directions. And I serendipitously fell into agenting, and it was a marvelous occurrence because it felt like a great marriage of my two different yet slightly related skill sets. I think that sales is to some extent a kind of performance, and of course I get to work with books and authors every day, which is such a terrific joy. I don't know if any of you come out of Columbia's MFA program. Okay, some of you do, I know you back there. I too have my MFA. Early on, I saw that there was an emerging need for agents who would work with their writers in an editorial capacity. And I think I speak for all of us when I say that we're very hands-on with our authors through every stage of the process, but especially editorially. And so I felt like I had some innate talent, but I wanted to hone my skill set. So that led me to pursue an MFA at the New School. And so I definitely identify with the writer's plight to some extent and psyche. And I think that experience informs my agenting practice significantly. In terms of what I represent and what I'm seeking, I represent literary and upmarket fiction. For me, voice is really critical, but the premise is as well. It's got to be a topic that I'm deeply invested in emotionally and intellectually, and something that I think editors are going to be excited about and stimulated by. And then I represent YA as well, and some narrative nonfiction. On the fiction side, I'm drawn to contemporary stories, international voices, anything that has mystery or suspense in its DNA. I also tend to gravitate toward or to things that have a fantastic element to them. I love historical novels if they're done well, or historical novels that also incorporate a contemporary strand to the story. And in terms of nonfiction, I love to work with journalists. I love memoirs that transcend the author's life and are offer a broader lens onto a particular social or political issue. That's me.
Hi, everyone. I'm Dado. Born in Bosnia, grew up in Brooklyn. I started Japanese at Sanford High School here in New York, local New Yorker, and then went on to Middle Ray for where I studied Chinese and Japanese literature. And I thought I was going to be a doctor of Japanese literature. That was the path. So I realized I liked making deals more than making administrational allies, if you will. I lived in Beijing for 5 years, first trained as a foreign correspondent, and then went to work for China Citic Press, which is one of the largest trade publishers on earth and the largest nonfiction publisher in Asia. I was an acquiring editor there. I was acquiring 100 books a year, which is 10 times more than most editors do. It's on the academic model, though, so I would read the proposals that were coming in from every agency and publisher in the UK and the US, figure out what we wanted, find an editor for it, and then a few books I acquired were Steve Jobs by Walter Isaacson, Decision Points by George Bush, the Henry Kissinger book on China, but then also interesting, smaller, Private Quiet by Susan Cain. Got stuck in very great book. we use that book as a comp quite often. And Folio is one of my favorite agencies to work with. The second book I ever acquired was one of Jeff's novels, Unsaid, by Neil Abramson. So as an agent, I obviously moved back to New York. As an agent, I work on a lot of fiction, nonfiction, smattering of fiction. But when it comes to fiction, I would say I'm looking for something really vital. Like when you see it, you're like, this is a necessary story for 2017. It grapples with issues that we all see around us, but in an inventive, engaged, interesting way. I love any work that engages with theory in some way. If that might sound airy, but if you think of The Sellout by Paul Beatty, social justice through anthropological means, it explodes out on page one and then kind of keeps speaking with it from there on. Or a book like Your Face and Mine by Jess Rowe, racial reassignment surgery and what that means to identity and kind of our social contract. Things like that really get me going. In terms of what I avoid, I wouldn't say right. The question is, what are we avoiding now? I would say nothing except what I avoid always, which is any straight shot genre with no greater literary aspiration. I'm just not the reader for that. I've never read a book. Any kind of family stories, happy endings, things that make you cry but in a sweet way, not for me. I like it dark and weird. Deep, yes. So between us, you can set it there. And on the nonfiction side, I work on, I would say cultural history, intellectual history, and then that's one list, and then health and cookbooks are my kind of bag. Especially photography or narrative-driven cookbooks.
Great, thank you very much. That each of you has largely addressed the first question that I prepared. What are you interested in representing in fiction these days? But if you overlooked anything, or if you want to elaborate as Otto did on what do you avoid, what should you not receive, please, any?
Sure. So Jeff just sort of whispered to me, you should talk about voice and premise more. So I will, and I'll try
anything.
And frame it in terms of what we avoid. Or perhaps avoid is too strong of a word. What doesn't jump out at us immediately or can be easy to overlook, and what you can do to bring your writing to the next level. Voice is so difficult to define. When we open a book, you know it when you see it. It is the, it's like music. You know a Bob Dylan song when you hear a Bob Dylan song. Bob Dylan doesn't sound like everybody else. And that is voice in a novel. So when I read the first page of a novel, I want to be drawn into the story instantly, but part of what does that is not merely what's happening in the plot, but the way the author is telling me what's happening and the author's voice. There is a kind of assuredness in the writing and a strength and a warmth that pulls you in. And so that's the first thing that jumps
can
out
I
at
give,
me.
Can I give an example of that?
Please do. Something better than my Bob Dylan example.
Yeah, no, I have a... this is this weird situation. I've been working with the same woman for 17 years, and she writes, I thought I wanted to do like real thrillers, like real genre stuff, that was something that was sort of appealed to me. And it turns out I don't really have the muscles to really do that. I don't think any of us here are real commercial genre. We need something that's a little more literary, a little it's called upmarket. As opposed to being something that's like a grocery store mass market. Does that make sense? We're kind of looking for something that's more book club. So this author of mine, I love her to death. She has great credentials. Unlike any of you, she is a furniture upholsterer in Upper Michigan, and that's her day job. So I'm gonna read you two paragraphs. So this first book I sold of hers like 10 years ago, like more, 12 years ago. And here it is. The air smelled of sulfur. I'm gonna make it first person. It's third person. You're gonna make it first person because somebody yelled at me about this. So, the air smelled of sulfur. At first, I didn't notice. 2 hours of climbing a steep, scree staircase of fractured basalt and volcanic ash that sent me sliding one step back for every two forward. And the closest thing I had to a conscious thought was an overwhelming desire for a level place to sit and slug from my water bottle. So, you know, you read that and you're like, okay, what's wrong with it? That's fine, right? Yes? Engage? Say no?
It's written in plain English. It's grammatical.
It's not much of a hook. This is her second book. Her first book had more, but I just had that one handy, so you're getting it. So this is this other book. And I don't know if you can tell any difference. If I told you my mother's name, you'd recognize it right away. My mother was famous, though she never wanted to be. Hers wasn't the kind of fame anyone would wish for. J.C. Dugard, Amanda Berry, Elizabeth Spark fame, although my mother was none of them. Can you hear the difference in that?
Yeah.
And what's like, and it's not like this is like rocket science. This isn't like, oh, the agent's so smart. Like, you all can see this. It's like so obvious on the page. So this thing, we sold, there were 14 bidders, and it went for a very sizable advance, and that was just North American rights, so we sold like 14 territories. And people are really excited about it because it has this really great premise and a great piece. So premise, tell us.
So premise. There's pitch and premise. A pitch is how we describe the book. It's the most distilled form of how we describe a book. A premise is sort of the jumping off point for a book. So they're related, but a premise is if this, then what happens. So what's, describe the premise of.
So I stick these two things together. So,
oh, you do? Okay.
But like, I think a lot of people are smarter than I am. The premise of this thing is called The Marsh King's Daughter. And what you're supposed to be able to do is boil it down really, really succinctly. So a really good premise is like early movie Splash. It's boy meets girl, she's a fish, right? You get it immediately. It's going to be funny and romantic. I can't do that with this. I still have it. It's longer. But basically, there's two stories. The one story is this psychotic prisoner escapes from prison, and his daughter realizes where he is, and she's the only person that has the skill set to get this guy back. So she's hunting him down, and that's the one part of the narrative. The second part of the narrative, you learn her story. She's actually the daughter, her father kidnapped her mother, and they live, it's like that room, you know? So she is the grown-up version of the kid in the room. And she, the past story is her coming to realize that she is the product of this horrible situation, and she and her mother have to escape. And so both of those stories are kind of going simultaneously. So that, in a long nutshell, is what the premise is.
So it's something, I think we all look for work that has a really strong voice that's evident on page one. And a story that feels fresh and intriguing and is easy to describe in a succinct and captivating way. Easy, right? And if you can put those two things together with pacing and with great characters, then you've got a great book.
But just to go back a piece, did any of you read the book called The Help? Have you heard of that one?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The editor is this woman who lives 8 blocks away. And she's really, really great.
You shouldn't disclose her address.
And her address is, I didn't say where, which direction. And she buys books for not a lot of money a lot of times. She's often an underbidder. But what she does is she says, I can fix a book if there's a voice. I can create characters, I can fix plot holes, I can do anything, but I can't manufacture a voice if it's not there. So I've never forgotten that. I think all of us think about that. Like, is there something there that you go, holy crap? And then you can fix the rest.
But with that said, I think it's always important for authors to share their best work with agents and to not rely on agents to be writing coaches or writing teachers. You do the work at home, you do the work at school, you make your product as strong as it can be, and you hone your craft, and then you come to us, and then we say, oh, I think it needs this, that, and the other thing. And then your editor will, of course, tell you that, too.
Well, when a writer is ready to approach you, they'll generally do that by sending a query to you. Could you tell us, how does a writer persuade you in a query that you're likely a good fit? Dada, would you mind switching?
Sure. The big things, and then a good query tells me who you are and what your community is. And by who are you as a writer? How do you exist in this world? How have people engaged with your ideas in the past? Where and how have you published? Where are you hoping to publish? What have you been sending on? Anything you can do to show me how you're seeing yourself in the next 2-3 years, in the next 5 years, helps me think about how to see your career as well from the first paragraph. And the community is so important. The publishing lore is littered with tales of people coming from complete obscurity to, you know, books that dominate discussions and bestseller lists for decades. But that's wildly, wildly rare. Almost all authors, they build their readership from the ground up. And all the connections that you've made, every published notable or at least published author that is in your orbit. Dropping some of those names really does help someone be like, oh, this person has done the groundwork to at least become part of this community. And that already gets you to the top of the heap. I think there's all this kind of like, I wish we could redo some of the queries we get because they are just so batshit insane. well over half of them. So really just a well written one with no typos, with some publishing credentials and already bumps you up to the to the front half of the heap, you know.
Go ahead.
And then just my nightmare is to see that done, and then the next paragraph about the book, and it's like I see this as the next Executioner song, or the next Song of Solomon, or just some like classic irreplicable novel that, you know, I really hope this is too. But are you going to make me wait 300 pages to figure that out? And what you can do instead, and I really suggest it, is the instinct is always to dive into plot, tell the person what it's about so they know what to keep an eye out for and what to read. But I would rather not know the plot, kind of have a general direction of where it's going, and instead have like write your own jacket copy. How will your novel be talked about? What does it engage with? What ideas does it engage with? And most importantly, what other recent books is it like? What other recent books will readers of your book have read or be reading or want to be reading? Which like shelf is it going to be on in the library? If you can help do that work up front, you will arm the agent with the power to read your book with a commercial mindset as opposed to an exploratory mindset. And that's really what you want to empower your potential agent to do. Because otherwise you're just reading a story and hoping it's great. And that's like the worst thing, place you want to be when querying.
Anybody want to elaborate?
I think this seems obvious, but apparently it's not, because we receive lots of queries that aren't appropriate to our agenting practices. And so I think it's very important for authors to carefully reach out to agents and to reach out to agents that they think are really appropriate for their work. I think a lot of authors think that they should just blanket the world and send out queries to every agent in New York. And elsewhere, yes. But I think you should do research into each agent that you are contacting and know specifically why you are reaching out to that person. And then clarify why you are reaching out to that person at the outset of your letter. I know if I receive a query and the author says, you know, I've read this book or I saw that your author was a finalist for this prize or won this prize, and my work engages with similar themes or could be seen, could appear on the bookshelf next to your client's book, then I'm more inclined to read. Then you've established a meaningful personal connection from the get-go.
But I feel like this advice has been kind of, people are getting it a bit more, and I'm noticing
it has to be organic. You have to really mean it.
So it's like make tailor it. And what I've been seeing recently is, dear Dado, I see that you're a fan of dark and gritty fiction, and it's always included because that's the shortest little snippet from my bio that you can pull out. So it's really just like the bare minimum of homework and research, which is not
you know, like, you better than nothing.
It's better than nothing, but it's just as rote and kind of just as easily dismissed. Like I now like groan when I see those a little bit. Whereas it's certainly better than nothing, but it's not making a connection by any means. It's just reminding me of like what are the first three words on my bio page.
The other thing I would say, which feels fairly rudimentary, but again, is important. Every agent likes to be approached differently through their queries. And so it's very important to read the instructions and to make sure that you are approaching that agent in precisely the manner that she likes to be approached. And the reason for this is we receive so many queries, it's very helpful to us if they're standardized. But also, we look to work with professional people who can follow the rules. And while I love a good iconoclast every once in a while, I also like someone who can abide by instructions. And so this is sort of that first test. Think of it as a job interview, take it seriously.
Let me ask for a little elaboration on a point you made, Dada. You don't want to see comps that are outrageous, like my novel is going to be the next Gone Girl. But many of us have read instructions for queries that say it's important to include a comp. What is your writing like? Do you agree with that, or is it not necessary? Are you often persuaded by interesting comps, or?
Oh, that's wildly important. It's just use reasonable ones.
Can I give a couple examples?
Yeah.
Is that all right?
Yeah, please.
So what I would suggest you guys think about when you think about the comps, because it is important, but to say I wrote the next Bible, you get that all the time. I'm the next Stephen King or whatever, and we don't believe it. So find books that are similar to yours in the following three ways. The author's credentials are similar. The voice is somehow similar, and or the themes are somehow similar. So credentials, voice, and themes. And then if, like my voice is just like Stephen King's, again, any of those lightnings in the bottle, any of these major bestsellers, brand names, those you discount.
Classics too.
Yeah, the classics, the Bible, Charles Dickens, like these are not helpful.
Salinger. Joyce.
Yeah. Because on this point, like this is another question that's coming up later, but what should you not include in a query? What you think of your own work is something you should not include in your query. Because you're immediately co-opting
in
the
work. In my luminous novel.
Yeah. which if I may say, is that's the kind of thing that you would never want to do because it doesn't communicate anything worthwhile, mainly. And you're stealing the thunder of your own work, and it just leaves a bad taste in the mouth of the reader, I think.
What is your ideal client like? Would you address that first one?
Jeff?
Oh, that's right. It's really weird, this job, because everybody on your side of the head desk is so desperate to want to get published. You really want this. And we are, at least I think many people, I am so desperate to find the next great writer. And again, we just came from Putnam, and all these people are sitting there saying, oh, I'm desperate to find this next book. I haven't bought anything in years. There's a lot of desperation. But what kind of sucks is authors turn very, very quickly from grateful to entitled. And how to get you guys not to be entitled. I'll give you an example. The guy I'm ready to strangle today. Worked on his book for 3 years, ended up selling it for a sizable chunk of change. He's a school teacher. He makes $36,000 a year. He doesn't have a lot of credentials, and he got $500,000 book advance. And so he immediately went out and bought a house. Like, he's doing all this stuff, which is, you know, great, and this is what you want in working on his book. And I'm using that number because it's important. This isn't like, this is a big advance. It was a nice size advance. And it's now time to do endorsements and do some work and like figure it, work on some stuff. So he emailed me some information that was basically a form. He didn't think it through. He didn't do the work because he's busy and he's important. He has a big book deal. And I wrote him back, look, I need these personalized. I need each of these things done deeply, thoughtfully, carefully. This is not something you do right away. And I got an email, look, I'm just too busy. I can't do this. And
too busy.
And so the thing that you get, and like you gasp, but when you're sitting there and all of a sudden you're a big deal, especially first-time authors, it goes to your head really quickly. And the person I love is the person that's been kicked around a ton. Because then, it's so easy to sit here on the side of the desk and be like, oh, I'm so important, I'm a literary agent or something. But we're working so hard, and our job is like miserable in a lot of ways. You're constantly kicking people in the teeth, and you can't get kicked in the teeth. And so you want to work with people who are like, look, we're on a team, we're doing this together, work with me. And it's hard to find that kind of collaboration. It's harder than you think.
You just made me feel really fortunate, because I feel as though I have the most lovely authors.
Most of mine are like this. Most of mine are great, but the rest of mine are like, oh, man, dude.
Let's say that we're working on a query, and we want to write that jacket copy that will get you interested in the book, brief synopsis of what you'll find in the book. Erin, what kind of things would pique your interest? What would it be more likely, the setting, the situation, anything you can describe?
It's interesting that you used the word synopsis, because I think what we really don't want is a long-winded synopsis of every event that unfolds in the book. If we're talking about fiction, I think that the word that you used, situation, mm-hmm. is probably the key word and the closest synonym to premise. I want to know what the inciting incident of the book is. I want to know the basic who, what, where, when, and why. Who's the character? What has incited them to do something? What is at stake? I don't want to know what the end of the book is. I want to feel incentivized to read it. And if the situation is compelling, then I want to pick that up. If the situation feels familiar or hackneyed or cliched or just out of the realm of what my interests are, then that's not something that I'm inclined to take a closer look at.
Thank you. Any elaboration, anybody? Any other tips that you have for query letters, what to include or not include? You've covered quite a bit on that. Did you leave anything out that we need to know about?
I would say to be discerning in the bio part of the query letter. It's really important to let the agent know what your accomplishments are, but make sure that they're real accomplishments. We don't need to know about how you won the 8th grade spelling bee. We don't need to know about unless you're writing a book about a spelling bee. We don't need to know about every publication you've ever had in obscure magazines. I would rather hear that you have been published in Glimmer Train, then, and that's it, then hear about that you've been published in, you know, 10 places that I haven't heard of plus Glimmer Train. I'd rather just hear about the impressive one. Residencies are really great to tell an agent about if you've been fortunate enough to have a residency. Columbia Fiction Foundry is a great thing to tell an agent if you have an MFA. I think it's important to tell an agent what's really, what you've done that's really vital, but omit things that aren't as important. In that case, short and sweet would be just
but
fine.
Erin, I have no publishing credentials. I've done nothing. What am I going to do? I can't. What am I going to write? I'm going to say I'm a first-time novelist. I've never been published. What do I do?
So that happens sometimes. My author, Daniel Levine, had never published anything, and he went on to have a New York Times notable book. But more often than not, I think that if you are a serious writer, you haven't squirreled yourself away from the world and you haven't been typing on your computer with no one else, without engaging with anyone else or forming meaningful relationships or seeking education or doing anything. If you're a serious writer, you've gotten into a group, you've done an MFA, you have availed yourself of whatever opportunities are available to you in your life or your community. And so it's important to tell an agent that.
I think something that we talked a lot about when crafting nonfiction proposals, but that I think is should very useful to fiction writers, is the idea of social proof. It's not talking about yourself, not talking about how great your work is, but using your connections to speak for you. And in terms of social proof, it's like just intimate, like give a sense of who you are by who you're with, if that makes sense. Talk about teachers you've studied with, people you've been in workshops with, and if you can get anyone to give you a quote whose name is recognizable at all, who you come, definitely use it. Just think about what's in your arsenal, what situates you in the world of letters, and try to get that into your query at some point, because each line of that is something that distinguishes you one step more than anything else that's coming in. And everyone has at least three lines of this. By being in this room, being part of this group, you have more than enough to write
right.
that out.
And chances are, if you're writing the right book, there's something in the book that is tied to your personal experience, and it can sometimes be useful to tell the reader that. For example, we'll just keep talking about The Marsh King's Daughter. The book is set in Michigan, and the author is from Michigan.
Who lived in the Upper Peninsula in the swamps.
Well acquainted with the local flora and fauna. So that gives her a kind of authority to write about that particular setting. That's useful. That's useful for an agent to know. Your credentials don't necessarily have to be tied to an institution or other famous people, though that is, of course, helpful, but it can be why you chose to write this book.
You mentioned how important voice is, that you want to see or hear the voice. What else, if anything, in a novel's first few pages do you really need to see to be engaged and want to read more?
Mine's quick, but you'll laugh. You won't believe it happens almost every time. Typos. Have three people read the first 10 pages of your professional copy. Don't send it out to a professional copy editor. Find editor friends to go through. Just don't give anyone a reason to say no, and the odds of yes are high. Always. And then also, when writing your kind of jacket copy, if you will, make sure that there's something in those first 2 pages or 10 pages that somehow is evocative of what you told us the book is about. If there's a big mismatch between the way that you frame how we should be reading it and what we actually see on those, maybe like the bulk of what you're talking about doesn't happen until page 50, but if you guide the agent in the wrong place when they start reading, they're more likely to put it down. So this book is about that. I have like other things. You know, that kind of thing could happen. So just make sure that something from what you share initially reflects how you frame the work. That helps.
For me, in the pages, themselves, and I always ask to see at least the first 10 pages of manuscripts that come in over the transom. It's about, beyond the voice and the premise, it's about conflict and tension on the first page. And I think a lot of people mistake this for heightened action. They think like an atomic bomb needs to go off and that's how I'm going to get your attention. It's not that, it's far more subtle. I have to feel deeply invested in what the character is going through. I have to care about the character almost instantly. It doesn't mean the character necessarily has to be likable, but I have to empathize with the character and want to stay with them for a while. And I have to care as much as they do about what's going wrong. It could be that they're waiting on a train platform and they're late and they need that damn train to come. But in the right writer's hands, that situation is far more effective than an atomic bomb going off.
But you can't care about the character until you know about them. So I'm going to give you all the background about their mother and where they grew up and what they had for breakfast. And
a novel, I didn't realize we're talking about a lot about fiction. About nonfiction at all. I know it's the Columbia Fiction Foundry.
Right, we focus on fiction. I know some of the audience is interested in that.
Okay. You don't want to data dump, as it's been dubbed. A novel is an act of discovery. You want to get to know this person and evolve with them as you progress through the pages. It's so dreadfully boring to learn everything about the character right up front. That information needs to grow organically out of the action of the novel. And so while a reader needs to feel grounded at the outset and has to have a basic sense of where we are physically in time in terms of the world, and who we're talking about and what's happening, we don't need to know everything.
Let's say one of us gets an offer of representation. I would be so excited, I would really be tempted to say yes right away. What are the questions we should ask before doing that, before accepting an offer of representation? Jeff, could you start with that?
So being a literary agent requires advanced degrees and years of study. You have to be able to spell A-G-E-N-T. If you do that, you are a literary agent. You'll never be able to do it, none of you here. So there's a lot of scams out there. And there's a lot of agents that are kind of shoddy. Scams, lots of scams out there. So one of the things you want to make sure is the way, I have a 17-year-old daughter who's actually supposed to tour Barnard tomorrow. And she doesn't eat if I don't sell a book. That's how I live, is selling books. And I don't think we're particularly mercenary and cutthroat and all that kind of stuff, but I don't eat. Like, I don't make a living if I don't have a book that I can then take out and do something with. Does that make sense? So all these books that you think are interesting and you love them or whatever, my kid has to eat. She totally eats every day. So why is this important? Because there's a lot of agents, it's a miserably tough way of making a living. And so one of the things you can do is, you know, I'm going to charge this gentleman $5,000 marketing fee or a $20,000 editing fee. So one of the big things to be watching for is people who charge fees. Another thing that I found that becomes an issue, I would always ask when you're talking to agents for recommendations from clients. Of course, they'll always give you like their favorite client, so I don't know how good that is, but still, they can give you a sense of how the agent works. I kept hearing about this one agent who wouldn't ever meet in person with the client. Like she'd work on email or phone, and the client really wanted to meet in person, and that was really important. And like, I think she actually wasn't in New York; she was in like Bombay or something. But so it's helpful to know the kind of working style that these people have. The other thing, there's this woman called Judge Judy, you know? And I always think of Judge Judy. And one of the things about publishing is it's all done in a handshake. It's a very gentlemanly business thing. And so I would easily say to an author, we're working together. And that's fine, but if Judge Judy heard me saying that, she'd be like, where's the paper? You know, give me, show me something, right? We'll tell Judge Judy be so all over you. So if they don't have an agency agreement, I would always draft something if I were you. Dear lucky agent, so excited we're working together. I understand you're taking 15% and you're not taking expenses, and you can get this all online, but always have something in writing so when Judge Judy comes to you, you have a paper.
On that Judge Judy point, you know, during the courting process, an agent can say anything to you, and then you can sign to them, and they don't have to really do anything that they said they would do. Work with you editorially, heads on, a lot, like hold your hand, work on revisions, help you get endorsements, help you arrange paperback publication. All these things sound really great. They're so easy to say, but really hard to do. And when people get busy, their things start dropping out. That's why, especially if you're lucky enough to have more than one offer of representation, you can ask for things. You can ask to speak to current clients. You can also get a subscription to Publishers Marketplace and look at all of that agent's clients. Look at the authors who have switched agents. You can then reach out to them on your own, figure out why without letting them know. This is probably, agents lose clients pretty regularly, but almost unless the person is a bit batty, which you'll be able to tell yourself on the phone or if you ever get in touch with them, there's still a huge level of respect because you went through something formative together. So it cannot often be, you know, to hear glowing things from an ex, you know, about someone you're planning to date. Think about it like that. You know, there's no more worthwhile testimonial than, you know, the rejector, if you will. So,
with that said, I mean, we've talked about agents who are unscrupulous, and we've talked about agents who maybe have a heavy workload and don't live up to their promises, though I will say that by and large, I think we all do our level best to treat our clients with respect and to live up to the promises that we make them to them. But, you know, sometimes it doesn't work out. There's a parting of ways. But with that said, I think that we all, at least at Folio, aim to have long-term relationships with our authors and see them sort of holistically as authors with a capital A. It's not just about one project, it's about an entire career. Maybe I shouldn't speak for everyone, I think I do, but at least I'm speaking for myself.
So Erin, I wrote this beautiful literary novel and now I just wrote a Western on poetry. What do I do with it? Sell it for me, Erin.
Well, the author and I always have a conversation at the outset about what they want out of their career and how I think I can help them achieve those goals. And if I don't think I'm the right woman for the job, then I will say so. But chances are, if we've gotten to that point, then I think that we are a very good match. And if we work together as a team, we can be even stronger than they would be on their own. If those Western poems are brilliant, then I am going to do everything possible to find the right home for them. If I think that this is going to taint my author's career, then I have the kind of relationship with my authors where I can, first of all, I would probably know if they were writing these Western poems, but if I didn't and this came out of the blue, I would be able to call them up and say, hey, so-and-so, hey, Erica, there's certain things I admire about this, but I don't think this is the right step for you, and I think you're shooting yourself in the foot, and this is why. And we would have a dialogue about that, and we would come to terms at that point.
Let's talk a little bit more about working with an agent. A couple of our members have signed with agents recently, and they're now in the process of beginning revisions. And so I know about their experience, but I'm curious about the broader experience, of how much variability, how much revision, a little, a lot, does it vary from client to client? And then once you sign with the public, sold it to a publisher too, a little curious about the time and the work involved before it gets in print. Jeff, would you start some?
So this is a crappy job, and I think we all are, I keep saying this, we all are kind of sharks. I always think of us as sort of sharks, and we're good at finding the blood in the water when it comes to editing. Like, we know when something's wrong, and so my job is to say, dude, your arm is bleeding. And your job is to say, no, idiot, it's my shoulder, it's not my arm. So a lot of times we will know there's a problem, but it's your job to be able to really figure out what that problem is and how to address it. I know there are a lot of agents, and this is something that comes up a lot. An agent will get the manuscript in, maybe not even read it, and put their stamp on it and send it out to publishers. So that happens a lot. So the question is, you know, if you have this agent and they're really editing, I mean, we all spend like hours, like days working on these manuscripts. So our job is to take it from point A to point F, let's say, and you get it to the point where the author is not going to make further changes. So one woman whose book I sold last year, it took her 9 months for the first revision. And then the second one, which was equally problematic, took her only 4 months. And then the third time, it took her 2 months. And the last time, it was like a week. And you could see, like, she's like, okay, let's get it out. And it had this one core problem that she never resolved. We ended up selling it, but every single pass had this one core problem left. So that we find a lot. But the big thing we can do is we can take it to a certain point until the author sort of is done. And at that point, we hopefully pass it on to the editor, who then takes it to the next level, that sort of publishing level. And how long can it take? It can take anywhere from a week to 7-10 years.
I think it depends on at what point the author signs with the agent, or conversely, at what point the agent signs up the author. I mean, I've worked with authors for years on books that we then sold and went on to be critical successes. I've also signed things up that I did very little to editorially and then sold at auction. So it really depends. And I think to return to your previous question, when you are talking to an agent about potential representation, one of the questions you should ask is, what is your plan for my book? You know, what will this process look like? What's your vision for it? Will we be doing editorial work together? How long do you think it will take? I know you don't have a crystal ball, but what would you estimate? How do you see my book? Where do you see my book? What potential publishers or editors, if you have a working knowledge of who's in publishing? Some authors do, most do not, and you do not need one. All of these are important questions to ask.
Thank you. It was 2 years ago, I think. I went to the Brooklyn Book Festival and was listening to a speaker, and one of the speakers said that authors should begin marketing their books before they finish writing them. And that I got the impression they were talking about nonfiction, but also fiction. I'm curious whether you agree with that. Dado, do you have any thoughts on that?
I don't really agree with it, mainly, or rather, I agree with the spirit behind it, which is start marketing to yourself as the person who deserves this platform, this megaphone, this opportunity. Don't market the book, market everything you have, everything you've studied, everything you've synthesized in order, assuming that to have made this book a success. So start marketing yourself, start getting outside writing opportunities, start writing, start being a commentator on certain nonfiction issues that your book touches on, or on current events. I think the spirit of that argument is there, but like marketing something before you have a deal, before you have an Amazon page, you're cannibalizing your own potential flow through. You can start selling your book the second someone can pre-order it, and if you can pre-order a novel, if you can drive pre-order sales for novels, your publisher is going to love you so much, because that does not happen very often at all, even with megastars.
I think to echo something that Otto was saying, it's important to market yourself in the sense that I think it helps both your platform as a novelist and your craft if you are an engaged literary citizen. And there are so many different ways of being an engaged literary citizen, whether you are attending the Brooklyn Book Festival and going to panels and learning about the industry and hearing what other writers and masters of their craft have to say, or you are on Twitter and you're following your favorite authors and seeing what they have to say and perhaps even engaging with them every once in a while, or supporting the literary magazines that you hope will publish you or that have published you. And Twitter's also, and Facebook, are wonderful ways to keep your writer's group together if you are actually in different physical locations. So these may seem like small social interactions that don't amount to much, but I actually think they're really important, both in terms of one's personal and professional development, but also in terms of thinking sort of down the line toward marketing your book once you actually have a book deal. That person you were, you know, bantering with on Twitter may have a book deal before you, and because you've kept in touch with them all these years and you have a friendly rapport, maybe they're now going to blurb for you. So it's those small things. Just be a good human. And
a good chunk of agents lurk on Twitter like you wouldn't believe. I haven't signed anyone yet through it, but I've had three conversations that almost ended in an offer representation just from seeing writers tweet at and engage with some of my favorite writers. It was like, huh, like, and watching new interesting, everyone wants a new interesting conversation. That's what thinking life is about. And if you can do that in any way, and especially in a traceable way, that like, you know, is there forever, do it.
So Julia is our Twitter superstar. Any, aside from Twitter, Facebook, any other ways to market oneself that you would suggest?
Can I stop this? Because this just makes me nauseous. because I totally agree with everybody's saying, and the other side of the coin, it really feels like you're missing the boat. It's all in the read. It's the craft. And I think this partially makes Folio a little bit different than some other agencies, because we really are focused on, and I will keep doing this, I'll keep bringing everything back to that moment you open that book up and you're like, crap, this is a world, this is a land, and I'm about to go on an adventure. You know that feeling when you're reading, and you're like, and that's why we read. So, like, this, the Marsh King Star we keep talking about, it sold for a ton of money, and it came with endorsements from Lee Child, and Jackie Michard, and Taya Obrecht, and there's like a list of, like, there's like 15 people that have endorsed this thing. Because the woman's so connected to the writer community, it didn't matter. The bottom line is people went home that night and they couldn't put the book down. And that's the thing I think is way more important than endorsements and Twitter feeds, is that you have sat down and really honed your craft and created a book and characters that you fall in love with. So, sorry to be.
I would further argue that I don't think that those two things are mutually
exclusive. They're totally
exclusive.
Not. They're not at all.
Your engagement on Twitter should, of course, not be at the expense of the development of your craft.
Because when people take it as a shortcut. Oh, I know, I'll get more Twitter followers instead of really drilling down and getting a voice.
No. But I do think that an engagement in the general conversation can steer you toward books you may have never discovered otherwise, and can also yield opportunities for meaningful professional relationships and friendships that might not otherwise present themselves.
You said that the three of you are more interested in upmarket book club fiction than strictly commercial fiction. And I have the impression that reviews are particularly important for the success of those kind of books. If you agree, other than, how do you garner reviews? Is it, does every well-written novel get reviews just by virtue of being well-written, or is there more that has to be done?
This is, to some extent, the purview of the publisher, and specifically the publicity department in-house at the publisher. As an author with a book deal, you will be assigned a publicist in-house. whether you want to bring in a freelance publicist to augment the publisher's efforts is probably a conversation that you will at some point have with your agent, and then your agent will help you negotiate that with the editor and with the publicist. But let's say you don't have a freelance publicist and you're just working with the publicist in-house. That's their realm. They will send out copies for review and contact the New York Times, and not for every book, for specific books. But some agents, I think, are more involved in the conversation about publicity with their clients than others. And I think some agents will help certain authors strategize about how best to utilize their connections and mobilize whatever resources they have.
I have a weird situation now where I have a book that's getting absolutely no review coverage. This first book did really nicely. And the reason is, it's a yucky topic. You don't want to read it. There's like lots of dead things. And not dead things in like an interesting way, they're like yucky dead things. I don't want to go into too many details because I don't want this to get back. But the problem is it's not getting any reviews, nothing's happening, and I think there's basic human nature, oh, yuck, I don't want to read this book. So, you know, when you're thinking about premises, you're thinking about this book, it doesn't have to be heartfelt and wonderful and happy endings, but you don't want to have a premise that you go, oh, God. Do you know what I mean? So that also plays a part in that human nature. You're going to pick up X versus Y. And all of what you cannot see, I'm sure all of you read that in the Anthony Doerr. Like you hear people talk about it, it sounds like, dang, I want to read that. Do you know what I mean? There's a girl and World War II, and that sounds cool. So there's that too. A premise can really help generate reviews.
Do you mind if we open it up to the audience?
As long as the questions are easy.
Anybody have any questions?
Well, it's interesting what you said about yucky topics, because my question concerns controversial topics. Would that scare people away, or would that instead prove more attractive?
More controversial about how President Obama is actually, you know, a transvestite.
No.
They
turn off the video.
Yuck. Is it controversial as in this is going to be like a discussion that people are going to be engaged in? It's just interesting. Like, it really is going to depend.
Did you have a question too?
Yes. Erin, you did an interview a couple of years ago, and you mentioned that on average you receive 40 queries every day.
40?
Yeah, you mentioned that during the interview.
And I don't think I received 40. I received something like 15.
Oh, okay. And if you look forward to read it every day. How many are you receiving now, and do you still look forward to read them every day?
So I received 15, not 40. I think maybe I was quoted and I do look forward to reading them every day. Sometimes I don't read them every single day because I don't want to miss anything. And if I don't get to them until 10:30 at night, I'm a little afraid that maybe my judgment will be compromised. So sometimes I will wait until, you know, one day a week or 2 days a week and go through them in a batch until I feel like I can't see them clearly anymore, and then I'll stop. But I do keep up to date with them, and I'm always looking to fall in love. I'm always looking for that wonderful project to come over the transom and surprise me.
So can you give me statistics just because it makes the thing easier? So let's say you get 10 a day. Okay, so that means you get, let's say, 4,000 a year, right? And it's probably much more like 15,000 to 20,000 sometimes. So, but let's say you get 4,000 a year of queries. And out of those queries, how many think you're taking?
Well, I always have FOMO, but to be honest, out of them, I can count to 12. 1, 2.
She's counting on one hand.
I think that I've taken on 4 or 5 authors from my solicited manuscript, or my slush pile. In 4 years. So 1 a year.
How many would you request more material from
and then pass on.
And decide no.
I think that I'd probably request two manuscripts a week.
Okay, so out of those, okay, so let's say Erin has now taken up one out of 4,000, okay? So she then sends it to an editor, and I had lunch with this editor, and she was telling us she gets 500 manuscripts a year. So it's like one to two a day, including holidays and Sundays, right? So 500, and she takes on four manuscripts.
A year,
4 to 6. So like those odds suddenly are like, holy crap, there's no way you can do this. Yeah.
I talked about this with her at lunch too. We had separate lunch.
So it's because she talked about that certain thing, but anyway. So when you hear those kind of odds, like on the other side of the coin, the book that has that voice and that premise, it's very easy. I lost a beauty contest recently. He sent to 5 agents and get 7 offers for presentation, and the book went for a very solid 7 figures. And why is that? Because it had a dynamic premise and a gorgeous voice. Those two pieces really make a difference.
Could you add a question?
Yes, this is about really your process of choosing like which offers you're going to sign. Because every book is going to need at least a little revision, that means that when you offer a presentation, you by definition have like a flawed product for lack of better terms. So how do you know that a book is a good enough bet that you're willing to take on an author who may or may not be able to revise it into something you like and something you can sell? Like, what is it that makes you want to take that leap?
Sure. I'm going to give you 2 different answers. The first answer is that I have to see that the author is capable of making it a book. You know, it can't just be a great premise and great writing, but I don't know how to make it a book, and I'm not sure the author does either. It has to have that basic infrastructure where it looks like a book, but it's just not quite there yet. And then I have to have the right vision for working with the author and knowing how to fix it. The second answer to your question is that every once in a while, someone's voice, I will find it so incredibly staggering, and they will have a concept that I think is just incredible, and I'm at a place where I feel like I have room on my list to take them on responsibly, and it's not going to be to the detriment of my other authors. And I will either say, let's keep in touch and work together unofficially, or I will give them a revise and resubmit with notes and say, this is what I think, I'm investing in you in terms of like my thought capital, please come back and share with me what you've written and revised. And then sometimes like I will sign that person if I feel like I have the bandwidth for it and I feel passionately enough about that project and that person.
We also have some tricks up our sleeves to protect ourselves from that very question. I know one thing I often do when you're in a beauty contest, what we call when an author submits to a lot of agents simultaneously and then you're competing with other agents for it, you're in a mad rush to sign that person to get them on paper so that anything you do together, you're protected for. But on the flip side, this has promise. I'm not 100% sure the author can do it. And what I'll usually do is go, and this works more for nonfiction because it's a bit of a shorter process, but I'll go through 2 rounds of revisions to see if we're on the same page and if that technical skill, that understanding of the flaws is there. But at a minimum, for fiction, I give a notatory letter and have a conversation. And if, like the point is to get something that's like at least 90% of the way there or 95% of the way there, and then have a like complete alignment of what the steps are that to get to the finish line.
Jeff, and it's a complete question, and it is the following: what is the link between literary and commercial?
The link between literary and commercial. So this book, Our Race in the Rain, okay, it was beautifully written. I could totally see it being a literary novel. I said to this editor, he called me up on Sunday in tears. He's like, I can't, and it was from a very literary house. He's like, I can't buy this book. And I was like, why not? And he said, because it's too commercial. I'm like, but it's pretty clear. He's like, it'll sell too many copies. Whoa, dude. So I go, what I guess the difference is, and it's something really in the writing, where you sometimes feel that it's maybe a little bit less focused on that premise that's going to really drive the story forward, and more focused on the writing, the voice, the characters, that things are a little bit quieter. And what I think, the thing that everybody is looking for is that book that is beautifully written, but also has that ability to hopefully sell copies.
What?
To sell copies. So when we talk about commercial and upmarket commercial and literary, I think it's sort of a scale. So like there's this downmarket commercial, which is the first term, and that's sort of mysteries and like Harlequin romance is considered downmarket commercial. And then, correct me, like if I start making mistakes here, and then there's regular commercial fiction, which maybe is not genre fiction, it's not beautifully written, it's just solid. And that's really tough because you sort of, you don't know where to put that on the shelf. And then there's upmarket commercial, I consider that sort of book club fiction. Like that's the stuff you talk about, it's really well written, but it's still pretty accessible. And then there's literary fiction, which can be that accessible, but can also be less accessible, you know, more focused on, again, voice and character. Does that make sense? So somewhere along that scale, you're going to fall.
And there's no bigger red flag than an author who doesn't know where on that scale-ish they are. When they're pitching something like a breakup story that they're calling literary fiction, and we often see this also with YA, where someone's pitching what's really middle grade, but calling it YA, but there's no romantic element, like you're immediately not writing a YA novel. If it's an adventure story up in Egypt, you know, with quests, that's like, it's just not part of like, YA stuff.
With regard to the categories of literary versus upmarket commercial fiction, I think some books are very easily categorized. This is definitely upmarket, this is definitely literary. But these categories are also becoming more porous, I think. And sometimes there can be a title that's both, and is at the intersection of the two. Or some people might qualify it as, or classify it as literary, whereas others would classify it as upmarket. So in those cases, it can be sort of tricky to know. So I think the definitions of those categories have always shifted.
Yeah, I'm just curious, after it gets the query letter, how does material circulate? Is it hard copy, soft copy, everything, Microsoft Word?
What's electronic, everything is Word or PDFs?
At most agencies, I worked at a paper agency. It was old school. Lots and lots of paper. But I would say that most agencies are.
A nice courtesy is asking the person who requested further, but not making a big fuss about it, but quickly asking, would you prefer Word document or PDF? Some people, taking, pop it on their iPad and start reading on the way home, you're that much closer to getting an invested reader. Whereas I don't like to really waste time with double reads. I like everything Microsoft Word, so I can start line editing right away, and I don't have to go through something.
I know that on your website it says to submit to one agent at a time, your agency, but do you ever share things amongst yourself? Do you think a colleague would connect better with the voice or something like that?
We all know each other's voices. Like, it's so easy. This is totally an Erin project and forward.
Any other questions? Just very quick. Craft question. I'd be interested in all three of your responses. We're evenly divided in the Columbia Fiction Foundry on prologues. About a third of us think they're nuts. It's crazy to start with a prologue. About a third love prologues, and about a third don't care. Where do you guys stand on prologues, or don't you care?
It depends on the book.
What can't call chapter one? Who cares?
That's my view.
It signals, correct me if I'm wrong on this, to me it signals commercial right away, because you're taking kind of a shortcut of situating the story. So you're immediately kind of, which it can be good if that's what you think you're writing and that's what you want to be writing, and it can be really, it can throw you off the rails if you think you're writing literary fiction. This will be reviewed in the New Yorker. And some books still do that, but...
Like, The Miniaturist begins with a prologue, but that's an interesting book. That's a book that is at once literary and upmarket. It appeals to both audiences. Jesse Burton's debut novel, The Miniaturist, her sophomore novels, coming out shortly. But that's a book that straddles those two genre lines, and it begins with a prologue. It's called The Miniaturist. By a British author, Jesse Burton.
So let me ask a question just to follow on to that. So there's a case where the author, if they truly knew what they had, would say, it fits into this genre and that genre. But to your point, they would sound confused to you. So how do you deal with that? I mean, if they said it straddles both, two different genres.
I don't think it should be a question of marketing, like, I want this to be commercial, I will add a prologue, or I don't want this to be commercial, I want this to be literary, no prologue for me. I think every book is different and calls for something else, and where does your story need to start to be the best story it can be? If that means a prologue, do the prologue. If that means starting with chapter one, I think that means starting with chapter one. And you, as the writer, know that best. Until your agent or your editor tells you otherwise.
On this issue of commercial versus literary, the rough and tumble definition I've seen that I actually find quite useful, it's probably not 100% effective, but I've heard if it's character-driven, it's literary. If it's plot-driven, it's commercial. I don't know if you guys buy that. It's my working assumption in our group. If I'm wrong, maybe tell me, but not while the quarters are going.
And to me, it's all in the voice. Everything you look on that page, and you can have some character-driven thing, and it has sort of a commercial writing style, and it's commercial no matter how character-driven it is.
Voice is really—it's the gauge of. You can think of it as the gauge of excellence, kind of like the.
No, just think of the gauge of a certain type of writing. It's nothing wrong with commercial fiction.
What I'm saying. It both commercial fiction and literary fiction can both be excellent. You know, there are genres for a reason. Every genre has examples of excellence and subpar. And so voice is necessary in everything. I would say plot-driven, definitely commercial. Literary, it can be character-driven. It can be thematically driven. There's more drivers in literary, I would say, than there are in commercial. So that's a...
Jeff, did you have some additional thoughts on
that? One of the things I think that we kind of think about all, and I don't know that it's, I think it's pretty clear, we really become your editor. We are your first editor. And so we see a lot of fiction. It just really isn't ready. I mean, a ton. And so I just want to throw some ideas. I thought maybe you guys can kind of chime in. So there's four things I think that's important. One is really strong characters. So what makes characters strong is that they care. So, and this is what Erin was getting to, what's at stake. Do the characters care about something? Because we as a reader care about things when the character cares. So one of the big problems that I see in novels, especially first pages, is the atomic bomb goes off and then Laura stares out the window. there's this moment where, or it starts with, Laura contemplating her day. And sometimes these things are combined. But you want, it's not a question of getting something at stake. You want to have something that the character cares about. The character ruminating is not that. So be thinking very seriously. There's this thing called a character, and there's a thing called a reader. And your job is to get out of the way and let the character tell their story, because it's commercial or whatever. So if you are writing this book, make sure that this is, you're not standing there and saying, wait, stop! You don't know what Laura's hair looks like! You can't know, you can't go on without knowing Laura's hair! And it's you getting involved, because the reader doesn't care when Laura's a blonde, right? But it turns out that Laura is on this island with this ginormous ape, and he really likes blondes. So it's going to be really important that Laura's hair is blonde, right? So then it's not backstory, it's critical information. So part one, I want to just make sure it's clear, is you have characters that care deeply, and that you are letting the character tell the story. So that's sort of the first thing, and I kind of, like, people are nodding. It is so hard to find books that do that.
It's a bit like method acting. You really have to become your character and let them speak through you. Your characters.
And there's lots of, and like, I would totally, if you guys have, if you do workshops, I would interview each other as if you're your characters. I would so drill down until that character's voice is not yours and is theirs. And then when you reread your stuff, you'll be like, whoa, there's no way this character would be talking about the fact she's a blonde right now. Because, you know, she's worried about, running for president or something. Just, that's not what she cares about. So one thing is character. The second thing is momentum. And this is the other big thing, and they all go together. What is at stake? What is driving this thing? And you need to be really conscious. I always think in terms of, are you going to give the reader what they want to have next, or are you going to intentionally frustrate them? And either way is good, but you need to be thinking, and I guess by thinking of the reader, I'm thinking of myself. So are you going to give me what I want to read next, or are you going to intentionally frustrate me and not give me that? So Jane fell down the well screaming. Meanwhile, the opposite of the world, Peter was walking down the street, you know, whatever, and you're like, oh my God, I get to hear what's going on with Jane. And so maybe you want to really, you know, stop the action and keep going, but most authors are not that conscious of reading to really pay attention to what comes next. We did this podcast that I thought was, if you have a chance, it's, I can send you the link, but it's Salt Key Writers Retreat, SALTCAY Writers Retreat. .com/podcasts, I think. And we're gonna, I probably keep doing this, but I interviewed this guy named Lee Chai, who's a very commercial writer. And I kept asking, so what makes momentum work? And his answer is, every single word you need to be asking the question why. So, and the example he gave me was the example Erin used, the train was late.
Was it really? I haven't even listened to it. I should.
So, but he was really, and he looked on like a sentence, like word by word level on what makes momentum happen. And this guy basically writes his thrillers. And so it applies to everything, his momentum. So character, momentum, and the other things we kind of talked about already is voice and premise. And those are the things I think all agents are really focusing on. So as you're working with writers and working with your colleagues, really drill down and think about those things as you're writing, because it feels too often that people aren't focusing on those. So you want to disagree with everything I just said?
Dang.
Any other questions?
I guess one about the writers' conferences. One of our group members just recently signed with an agent she met at a conference, so, and I know, Jeff, looking at your bio, you go all over the world. It looks like it.
Only to like glamorous places.
Hawaii, Dublin. I said to Ralph, this is a thing. At least they feed you, hopefully.
I know. So last week I was in Hawaii, and next week we're in the Bahamas. It's like, oh, for you.
So my question is, when you go to these writers' conferences, what are you hoping to find there in terms of your engagement with writers pitching their stuff?
You want to answer that one?
Well, it's. I think you're always hoping that you're going to go there and meet someone whose book dazzles you, who you connect with, and someone that you want to champion their career. And you can find them right there and jet back to New York and send the book out and do a $1 million deal. I mean, I think that's what every agent hopes for. That is sort of rarely what happens. I think more often than not, and in some ways this is equally wonderful, you go and you meet someone who's working on something really interesting and has a voice that really resonates with you, and you want to stay in touch with that person and offer that person some preliminary advice to steer them in the right direction. And you strike up a correspondence with that person that then takes place over, you know, 6 months to several years, and then one day they come knocking on your door again and say, hey, you know how we met, I don't know, 4 years ago in Boston at that conference? That book that we talked about, that we corresponded about subsequently on email, it's ready, and I'd love for you to look at it. That's more often the story that we have to tell about conferences. At least, I should say, in my experience.
The RC manuscripts are completed. So the rule of thumb is, if you have a novel, you should finish it. And if you drink nonfiction, do a proposal. I've signed people up based on the first sentence. So it really depends. I remember I was sitting at a writer's conference and I was bored out of my head. And this author sent me this letter. She's like, "Well, this is all blowing up all over our website." And it's like a writer's website. She said, "You should read this." So I was sitting there, bored, clicking through it, and I read the first paragraph and emailed the guy right then saying, do you have an agent? And he's like, "No." I'm like, "Can I sign you right now?" And I was like, and by the time the conference had ended, I signed the guy up, which is kind of crazy. But it really, again, right, and that story was called Finn. It's this very dark story of Huck Finn's father. And the opening paragraph is a body drifting down the river, and the blue bottle flies are nibbling on it, and the fish are turning it into like this whole yuck thing. And you realize by the end of the first chapter, or a couple pages, it's Huck Finn's mother, who Huck Finn's father has just killed and skinned. And you immediately, but you're like, okay, this is going somewhere. This is not what I was expecting, and it's gorgeously written. So, you do, but that said, it's usually a huge mistake the reason that you want people to finish the book is because almost always your voice isn't assured enough. It's really tough to get something where the voice is really there.
So, I mean, I do a lot of outreach. I read literary magazines voraciously. I also sell short stories to literary magazines on behalf of some of Folio's clients and my own. And when I reach out to someone who I think is particularly talented and they write back to me, sometimes they won't have finished work, but I will feel compelled to take a look at what they're working on. Perhaps not to sign them in that moment, but to initiate that dialogue.
Do you actively poach writers from other agencies?
No, I'm
going to
answer
that. I'll turn the recorder off.
No, I'm going to leave it on because one of the things we do not do ever, because these are our friends that are other agents, and there are agencies out there, you may know them, that do this. "Oh, I can get you a better deal, buddy. You should come with us." And that is so not how Folio operates, and no one at Folio does something like that. And it is very often happens that an agent, that author's unhappy with the representation, and they'll come to us, and we are very nervous because we're worried not what's wrong with the agent, but what's wrong with the author. That usually is a bigger case. So no, we don't poach. If you're unhappy, the first thing we almost always do is say, "Go talk to your agent," because it's probably a communication issue. We do take authors that have other agents. And so I'm not saying we don't work with agents, but authors that haven't previously
had a different agent.
Thank you. But we don't ever go after somebody while they're represented and say, "You should work with us." Sorry, very passionate about that.
I'm glad I asked.
Yeah.
Yeah. In the case of my nonfiction book, initially I had a prologue, and the first editor told me to put it as an epilogue, and then the second editor told me to put it as a prologue.
So freelance editor?
Yeah, these are freelance editors. Now my agent is telling me to now switch it back. And I'm sort of wondering, when is it just a matter of opinion or whim, and when is it really? I mean, I guess I need to listen to my agent because that's the person who's made a commitment to me.
I think it is, to some extent, always a matter of opinion. Fiction, again, to some extent, is a very subjective sort of business. I mean, you could love a book that you purchase at the bookstore and give it to your friend, and your friend could hate it. I would say that you should listen to your agent, unless you vehemently oppose what she or he is recommending, and then I think it's worth having a conversation with them, because editing shouldn't be a dictatorship, it should be a dialogue, and sometimes the best solutions come out of that conversation between agent and author.
Do you have any questions for us? Or?
You're supposed to do this.
Send me a project.
So not our. Because I was once at a writers' conference and I spent the whole time talking to this one or two writers and I just loved them. And I thought, they're going to send me their stuff. But we're like, there's something about us. We don't ask a lot of times. We just assume people have a relationship. And this one woman, and she literally sold like 8 books for like $7. I think I had 3 books on New York Times bestseller list that month or something. And she got up there and she's like, send me a project. All the whole writers like glommed at her. She's like, by myself. Oh, did you lose me? So, you know, do keep us in mind for fiction and nonfiction if it's beautifully written. And
thanks for listening to us.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
T-shirt.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.